So what is TDFT? TDFT is an extension of density functional theory. It is a density functional theory with time-dependent external potential. So while in DFT the problem was to have a solution for a system with a static, for example, the ionic potential, the potential of the ion of the system, which was static. In TDFT, you consider the problem in which this potential becomes also time dependent. Why? Take all excitation, you need a time dependent external potential because the external potential is typically time dependent. It's an electromagnetic field varying in time. Or it can be, for example, a perturbation due to an electron, beam of electron, which is incident on the system. And so, again, like in EFT, you have the Hohenberg-Kohn theorem, which establishes a one-to-one correspondence between the external potential and the ground state electronic density. In TDFT, you have an analog, which is called the Runge-Gross theorem, which establishes a one-to-one correspondence between the time-dependent external potential and the time-dependent electronic density. So you see, again, in TDFT, like in EFT, the fundamental degree of freedom is not anymore the many body, very complex, with function of all the electrons of the system, but it's a reduced degree of freedom. It's the electronic density, so which in this case is a time-dependent quantity, unlike in DFT. However, it's already a huge compression of degrees of freedom. And so the fundamental milestones of TDFT are these two papers, the Runge-Gross 84 paper that set up the rigorous basis of TDFT, and then the Gross-Kohn 85 paper, in which, let's say, they started to explore TDFT in linear response, which is the next part of this lecture. The Hohenberg-Kohn theorem has been already introduced by Gianmarco in the first lecture. So the Runge-Gross theorem came and proved according more or less the same line. So it is in fact a reductio ad absurdum proof. In fact, what it the Runge-Gross demonstrates is that suppose that you start from a given starting electronic density, progress, a given starting point, but you evolve following two different external potential. Different means that they are different by more than a mere time-dependent constant. So the two potentials should differ by a quantity which is C of phi and T, not only C of T, because otherwise the two systems are equivalent. Then you end up with two different densities. So if you are able to demonstrate this relation, then you have also the back mapping. So that if this thanks to the Runge-Gross theorem, you can express any observable of the system. In principle, in quantum mechanics, you have to calculate this average value on the wave function, on the many-body wave function of an operator. In time-dependent density functional theory, it becomes just only a functional, so a function of a function, of the density, of the time-dependent density. Exactly like in DFT, you without the time dependency. Okay, there are some caveats about the Runge-Gross theorem. I do not want to enter into all these details because we are late. However, I just only mentioned the first point, which is an important one, because unlike DFT, in reality, any observable is a function not only of the density, but also in TDFT, there is a further complication, it's function also the initial state. So in this case, why? Because due to the time dependence, you know that it's you have to solve a differential equation in time, and for any differential equation, you need a boundary condition. And so you have to fix, for example, the initial state. This is a problem. However, very often you use the ground state, but also using the ground state, you run up into other problems. So the fact that, for example, at initial time t0 to be in the ground state means that the potential previous to t0 should have been zero for enough time for the system to relax to the ground state. So it means that you should have an external potential, for example, is a step like this. Or also, for example, a potential which has a discontinuity like this. But you know that the Runge-Grosse theorem has been demonstrated only in the case in which V of t can be expanded around t0, Taylor expansion around t0. And you see that all these cases cannot be expanded because there is a discontinuity of certain derivative, the first of the second. You cannot comply the two conditions having the external potential zero for enough long time for the system to relax to the ground state and not having a discontinuity at t0 to be into the hypothesis of the Runge-Grosse theorem. However, I have to say that the Runge-Grosse theorem has been demonstrated in other cases. So, for example, it has been demonstrated for the case of small time-dependent linear response cases, or other, for example, Laplace transformables, and so on. But however, you have to know that there is no general proof of the Runge-Grosse theorem valid in any case, even though you can imagine that it has been demonstrated here and there, and so you can imagine that the Runge-Grosse theorem is much more general than actually demonstrated. However, all these are mathematical issues that, of course, you can, if you are interested in the research into this field, of course, you can contribute, but you can stay, let's say, on the fact that the Runge-Grosse theorem is more general than what actually demonstrated. Then I continue to introduce the DFT with a in practice with again a comparison, so a zoological comparative anatomy of the two theory. We have already seen that in DFT you have this Hohenberg-Kohn theorem and analogous is the Runge-Grosse theorem. Thanks to this theorem, every quantity, every observable of the theory are unique function of the density. In particular, you consider the total energy in DFT, while in TDFT, since it's a time-dependent theory, you rather address to the action you have defined. So the action is a unique functional of the density. And then also for both theory, there is a variation. You can use a variational principle in both the theory. The stationary point of these two functional provide the exact solution of the system, so the exact density of the system. So you can really look for the solution of one. Suppose that you have the functional form of the energy or the action, you can find the solution by functional deriving and equating to zero, so searching the stationary point of this functional, and this will provide the exact ground state density in the case of the DFT and of the evolutionary electronic density in the case of TDFT. It's a way that you can follow. Also, in the case of TDFT, you can introduce a consham. You can introduce, let's say, you can consider the solution as provided by a consham framework, a consham system, a consham non-interactive system, like already illustrated in the case of TDFT. So, the only difference is that in the case of TDFT, the consham equation is a Schrödinger-like non-time-dependent equation. In TDFT, becomes a time-dependent Schrödinger equation here. Okay? In both cases, you write a consham potential, which contains the external potential, the Hartree, plus an exchange correlation term, which in the case of TDFT is calculated as the functional derivative, the rigorous definition of the exchange correlation potential. In this case, is the functional derivative of the action, the exchange correlation action of the theory, with respect to TDFT, where it is the functional derivative of the exchange correlation energy. Finally, in both cases, you build once you have solved the consham equation, you build the density as the sum over all the occupied state over all the occupied consham eigen function. So in many cases they are really different. So again, like in the case of DFT, you have the real system which is evolving according to the real external potential, time-dependent external potential, along, say, a path which is the real exact density of the system. You introduce this consham system under the hypothesis that the density is the same, exactly the same, rho of R and T are the same in the two systems. This is the hypothesis to build this consham system. And so you search for a consham potential that in the non-interaction, so switching off the interaction, the electron-electron interaction, seen as a mean field external potential containing beyond the external, contains also the Hartree and the exchange correlation part, provides exactly, after solving the consham equation, the same density of the real system. They proceed in parallel under the only complication of the time dependence. And you can really solve also the theory following this approach. This is the approach, so a real pace, a real time approach. It is a way which is really followed by, and in particular, you're going to have a lecture tomorrow by Claudio Attaccalite, real time approaches that will describe how to solve TDFT. And also among other theory, following this approach. Okay? Allora, now there are further caveats also of this question, so about the exchange correlation action and also this so-called causality symmetry paradox. However, I'm not entering into these details, so you have both my slides or also the review article that I put also on the SECAM site. You can enter all these details, and there are references where you can study all these problems. The only point I would like to raise with respect to these questions is that there is always somebody that is submitting on the archive an article saying, ah, TDFT is an incomplete theory, ah, TDFT presents this problem, so it's not an exact theory. This is not, in many cases, this is not true. Many of these problems have already been solved. There are some problems that, of course, still await for a rigorous rigorous mathematical formalization. But let's say in many cases, the theory is already, you can consider the theory already working without all this mathematical formalization. Okay, so now I pass to TDFT in linear response. So which is a particular way, an approximation to take on TDFT and the problem that you pretend to solve by using TDFT. So, and this is, let's say, it is what is contained in the gross count paper of 85. So suppose that your time-dependent external potential can be split in two parts, an external potential which is constant, so not time-dependent, and let's say a part which is truly time-dependent. And suppose that this part is small with respect to the static part, so you can consider this a variation with respect to the static part. Then, in this case, you can solve TDFT as TFT plus linear response to the time-dependent perturbation. So you consider this a perturbation of the most important part, and the most important, you describe the most important part by ordinary DFT, and then you once you solve the DFT problem, you apply linear response and you introduce let's say you can take all perturbations, so excitations, spectroscopy by a linear response approach. When this approximation is valid, the approximation holds, of course, not in the case when the perturbation is small. So this is not the case, for example, of strong laser perturbations. So when this is the potential, typically you take this as the potential of the ions, like in DFT, and this is the electromagnetic wave that is exciting the system. When the electromagnetic wave is small with respect to the static potential, you can solve the theory linear response. When there is a strong laser, of course, this is not anymore true. And in this case, for example, you can have an explosion of the system, thanks to a laser, because the external potential that glues nuclei in a condensed matter system is small with respect to the electromagnetic perturbation, and so the system can even explode. In these cases, in the case of stronger laser perturbation, you cannot address to linear response. You have to solve the theory by a real-time approach, like in the case of described by Claudio tomorrow, or also you can try to do in other cases where still this let's say where you can see to the non-linear response, so to the second order, third order response, if the linear response is a too gross approximation. But and this is the Valery Venier lecture of tomorrow. In the case of linear response, so you see that you can formulate the Runge-Gross theorem here, the one-to-one correspondence between the time-dependent external potential, the time-dependent density. You can express separately as the Homberg-Cohn theorem, and then a one-to-one correspondence between, because let's say, because there is already a one-to-one correspondence between V of R and the rho of R, like in DFT, the Homberg-Cohn theorem. So you have that there is a one-to-one correspondence between the perturbation and the external perturbation and the variation in the density of the system. And so you can really first, so you can really follow this calculation scheme. You first do a DFT calculation. For example, you find for an external potential, you find the electronic density and then all the Kohn-Sham orbitals energies. And then on top of this, you apply linear response. You calculate, for example, the density variation corresponding to an external perturbation. And then you can also calculate, for example, the functional derivative delta rho delta V, which is defined as the polarizability of the system. And then from the polarizability, you can calculate spectrum. So again, So I formulate this in a more rigorous mathematical framework. So this is the external variation in the external potential. This is the variation in the density induced by the external perturbation. The polarizability in linear response is defined as the coefficients of this relation. So chi is also delta rho over delta v, the functional derivative, or is the linear coefficients in this relation. In nonlinear response, of course, you will see tomorrow that you can add a K2 here to this relation. You can add the plus K2 delta v squared. Okay? In linear response, you stop to, you assume that this linear response is enough to describe your variation in the density. And so the purpose of a linear response DFT calculation is precisely to calculate this chi, which is the polarizability of the system. And this is the fundamental quantity associated to the condensed matter system, which will provide you, you will see all the observable quantity, neutral excitation, and other observable neutral spectroscopy that are in principle in the limits in the framework of TDFT. As also in linear response, you can introduce a Kohn-Chung scheme. So you can introduce a fictitious Kohn-Chung non-interactive system under the hypothesis that the induced density, variation in the density of the real system, the induced density, variation in the density of the Kohn-Chung fictitious system, non-interactive system, is exactly equal to the induced density, the variation in the density of the real system. Like in DFT, there was this assumption, this hypothesis. Here you do the hypothesis on the respective variation. And so under this hypothesis, you can, so delta rho here is equal to delta rho Kohn-Chung, you have another relation relating the delta rho, the variation of the real system equal to the Kohn-Chung system, which is provided by a linear response function, the Kohn-Chung polarizability, also called the independent particle polarizability, indicated in the literature as chi Kohn-Chung or chi s or chi zero. You can find all these notations. And the so-called Kohn-Chung external potential, external, sorry, Kohn-Chung variation. Okay? And this Kohn-Chung variation, Kohn-Chung delta v chi s, like in the case of DFT, is composed of the external, the true, what do you apply to the system, the external variation, plus the screening, that is a component which is the R3 component and the component which is the exchange correlation component. Okay? And these quantities can be written. For example, in the case of the R3 component, you can write as the functional derivative of the DFT R3 potential in this case. So if you do this derivative, functional derivative, you find precisely the Coulomb potential. And so the R3 variation is, you can write it analytically. While in the case of the exchange correlation perturbation, exchange correlation variation, this derivative, delta Vxe over delta rho, is what is called the exchange correlation kernel of TDFT. And this, again, like in DFT, is an unknown quantity that you need to approximate. Oh, you can stop whenever you like. Huh? This part is a little bit mathematical, a little bit heavy to follow, but okay. Then, also, you can all, there is also an analytical expression for the Kohn-Chung polarizability. So this the quantity which is appearing here in this relation between the Kohn-Chung variation and the real induced density. And this is the exact analytical form of the Kohn-Sham polarizability that you can calculate using the Kohn-Sham wave function and energies. You can demonstrate this relation starting from the Kohn-Sham equation of ordinary DFT and apply variation on the external potential. So I leave you as an exercise, starting from the Kohn-Sham equation that Gianmarco shown you in his slide, or that you know very well, and varying, so applying a delta V variation in the external potential of in the Kohn-Sham equation, you can derive this relation, which is called the Adler-Weissner expression for the Kohn-Sham polarizability, which is precisely this analytical form. So contains the Kohn-Sham wave functions, energy, and the occupation number. So these are one or zero or two or zero for occupied and unoccupied state. And this is the expression in reciprocal space, so in GG prime and Q. Okay, so in principle, you have this quantity. And then also by you have this fundamental equation. This is the fundamental equation of TDFT that you can derive by these two equations. So I remind you that the purpose of TDFT is not to calculate the key Kohn-Sham, which is the polarizability of the fictitious non-interacting Kohn-Sham system, but the purpose of TDFT is to calculate the real polarizability of the real system, so this quantity, okay? And from these two relations here, and from expressing delta V Kohn-Sham as the sum of the different terms, so the R3, the same correlation for which you have this expression, you can derive this fundamental expression of linear response TDFT relating the Kohn-Sham polarizability that you can calculate analytically from Kohn-Sham energies and wave functions from the Coulomb potential. So this is analytically known. And then from the exchange correlation potential kernel, you can so calculate from all this known quantity the polarizability of the real system. Of course, again, I remind you that the exchange correlation potential is not known, is an unknown of the theory. So in this case, you have to approximate. But you have all the ingredients to calculate chi, which is the real quantity, the real polarizability of the system from which you can derive all observables. So this is written in a Dyson-like form, which chi appears in the left and the right-hand side of the equation. But of course, you can explicitly write the chi as in this equation. Okay? Now, it's the end of the story of this mathematical part. From chi, you know that there is a relation between the polarizer, even a classical relation. So in the classical textbook of electromagnetism, you can find the relation between the dielectric function and the polarizability of the system. And this is, let's say, this written here. So the microscopic dielectric function is 1 plus Coulomb potential times the polarizability of the system. Pay attention that this is what is called the test particle dielectric function, is the dielectric function which is the real observable in a classical experiment. Sometimes you can also meet this other definition for the dielectric function, which is called the test electron dielectric function. With respect to the previous, it contains also the exchange correlation potential. This is somehow, let's say, non-classical dielectric function. In fact, let's say, in a classical experiment, to measure, for example, the dielectric constant, typically, if you remember in the classical physics textbook, to measure the dielectric constant, you have to take a dielectric, make a hole, put a test charge in the hole, and see how the system will screen this test charge, how this system will react to this test charge. But since the test charge you are introducing the Hall is a classical charge, so it's not another electron. So in this case, what you are measuring is a quantity which is classical, which so if let's say if you inject an electron, then you have to consider other terms, which are the exchange and the correlation of this electron with the other electrons of the system. But in a classical experiment, what you are doing is to introduce a classical charge. So it means not an electron. You can introduce a muon or another negative among all the zoology of elementary particles. You introduce a particle which is different from the electrons of the system. So it does not obey to the Pauli principle, does not exchange with the other electrons of the system. And so in this case, you have to consider this test particle dielectric function, which does not contain the exchange correlation part, which applies only if you are doing the experiment with another electron, okay? With a non-undistinguishable particle from the particle of the system. So in order to compare with classical experiment that use a classical test charge, you have to calculate this dielectric function and not this one, okay? Then this dielectric function is a microscopic dielectric function. So you are calculating something which is epsilon of r prime or epsilon of gg prime q. Then in order to compare with classical experiment, you have to average. And averaging, you have learned from previous lecture that corresponds to taking the zero-zero element of the inverse matrix, okay? So after having calculating the microscopic dielectric function of TDFT, you derive the macroscopic dielectric function that you can later use to compare with experiment. In particular, for example, you can compare with the optical absorption, imaginary part of the microscopic dielectric function, or the energy loss function, which is minus the imaginary part of the macroscopic, again, the microscopic dielectric function. So you have all the quantities, all the observable, the system, once you have calculated chi, microscopic epsilon minus one, and macroscopic dielectric function. Again, I insist on the fact that the correct definition of the macroscopic dielectric function is one over the zero, the head of the inverse dielectric matrix. If you, on the other hand, you take the zero-zero element of the direct matrix, you are neglecting so-called local field effects. So the non-diagonal part of the dielectric matrix. And as you have seen in the relation that Francesco already shown, this non-diagonal, so typically this non-diagonal part refers to other wavelength that are introduced. So here you see the wavelength of the external perturbation, G prime. This is the fundamental wavelength of the perturbation. But under the response, the total, so the screened electrostatic potential can contain other components that comes from the internal crystal field components of the system, which arise from the non-diagonal part of the microscopic dielectric function. And this can affect even the dielectric constant, so the zero component of these quantities, okay? So in particular, you will see what is the difference in calculating the microscopic dielectric function, neglecting this non-diagonal part, so taking the head of the direct matrix, with respect to taking the correct definition.
Thank you. If I add the local fluid, the only thing I get is a rigid blue shift, or I have a change in the entire field.
You may have a complete change in the shape of the spectra. No. And by region shift, you mean in frequency. No. Rather, the effect is rather not a shift, but rather a modification of the oscillator spectra, of the spectra. But this is not rigid in any case. A good question, but we will see the different, let's say, the effect of local fields are going to be analyzed in detail in the next lecture. So, okay, still at 1 hour. Other questions about this part that I'm going to quit? Okay, I just only resume. So all this boring mathematical part, and then if you have a question, you can ask. So in one slide, the fundamental equation of a linear response to DFT. You solve, so the scheme is first you run a DFT, an ordinary DFT calculation, calculating the Kohn-Sham energies and wave functions and the Kohn-Sham ground state density. Then, thanks to the Kohn-Sham wave functions and energy, you calculate the Kohn-Sham polarizability or independent particle polarizability by the otherwise expression. Okay? And then use this ingredient as input for the fundamental equation of linear response to DFT. Once you have decided an approximation for the so-called exchange correlation kernel. So here you have all the ingredients to calculate the polarizability of the real system on top of the non-interacting Kohn-Sham polarizability. Once you have the real system polarizability, you can calculate the microscopic and macroscopic dielectric function, and which will provide you all the observable, the spectrum of the system. Okay? So in the calculation scheme, after the DFT calculation, you calculate the Kohn-Sham. Then you assume an expression for FXE, which in principle is a function, again, a function of the density. So you can use the density. There are other expressions which relies really on the orbitals, like in DFT. There are some expression of the exchange correlation potential that rely not on the density, on the orbitals. And then with these two ingredients, you solve the fundamental linear response equation of DFT to calculate chi, microscopic epsilon, and microscopic epsilon.
If I somehow have the exact problem.
Good question. Allora, while in the case of the exchange correlation potential, it has been possible by reverse engineering. So if you know the exact solution, like the helium atom, the Hiller solution, you can do a reverse engineering and calculate the exact exchange correlation potential. You can plot, you can have it on your computer, even analytically, if you solve. In the case of TDFT, I don't know any system for which we know the exact exchange correlation kernel of the theory, apart for the homogeneous electron gas, for which also, let's say, we have accurate expression, but not yet the exact exchange correlation kernel, even for the most simple case model, which is the homogeneous electron gas. So unfortunately on this, and also pay attention, that this quantity is in a not observable quantity. So in principle, let's say, has several degrees of freedom. So you can find more than one exchange correlation kernel that provides exactly the same chi. You see? So you can play with these degrees of freedom. For example, one degree of freedom for which you can play with is that you can, for example, have a This FXE is, to go a little bit this. In principle, this quantity is non-local and also frequency dependent, omega. But you can play with this. So in practice, since this is not observable, you can have just only one non-local exchange correlation potential that provide the exact answer, or you can have one only dynamical and static and local exchange correlation potential that also provide the exact answer. Since this quantity is unobservable, so nothing that you can observe in an experiment, there are some degrees of freedom from which, so you are free to play with approximation for it that are more useful for you, for your kernel. So having a kernel which is only non-local and static is good for a calculation. But unfortunately, so I don't know any exact expression, not even for simple models. You?
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Can you also compute this self-consistently, such that you don't have a dependence on the Concham states, for example?
Well, in the case of general TDFT, so not the linear response scheme, you have to do it self-consistently, like in DFT. So yeah, so you have yeah, in the case of yeah, coming back to the equation of yeah, you can solve following this scheme. So you apply, for example, starting with a given assumption of rho far t, guess, you apply into the expression for the Concham potential, you solve this, you go back exactly like in DFT. In the case of linear response, no. There is no need to do a self-consistency. Why? Because you have already done the self-consistency for the static part. You have found the rho of r for the static part. And then on top of this, you just only apply a little perturbation. So you do not gain, let's say, in apply. So once you have found the delta rho, you do not gain to redo. So linear response in DFT is one shot on self-consistent. After.
Just to
No. I give the prior because it's already talking. So
thank you.
The case.
So I have some question about classical potential.
You have some question?
Classical potential.
Classical.
You said that there is classical potential and quantum classical. And quantum potential.
Yeah, okay.
So is it somehow true to have combination between the two type of potential? Because particle can be seen that as form of quantum particle or classical particle.
If you want to, if I can have a
combination
kind
between
two.
Maybe to
But
see the quantum effects of
yeah,
possible.
allora, so so you refer to this slide, no? I guess. A combination of what do you mean a combination? You see that the difference is just only in this term, no?
Okay.
So,
So is
by
it correct to
combination means that you take this term one half. I mean, you can consider either this total potential or this one. It depends. Let's say I can imagine
Which
doing
one
an
is
experiment.
correct?
So, for example, the spectra that Simo has shown you are classical experiment. So a kind of experiment in which you do the ideal experiment, in which you take a dielectric, you make a hole, you put a charge inside, and you can consider this charge as different from the electrons of the system. And so in this case, discharge only fill a screening which is a classical screening, so the R3 screening. So the system, the other electrons of the system rearrange to screen, so they arrange to put a positive charge around the negative charge. You can all even take a positive charge, so not an electron. You can put inside the system, I don't know, an hyperon, or I don't know, an elementary particle which is positive, okay? A meson, a pion, a positive pion. And so this pion has nothing to do with the electrons of the system. And so in this case, it only fills the screening, which is a classical, R3 classical screening. While if you put an electron, I can imagine an ideal experiment in which I put in the hole an electron, and these electrons, already, of course, is the same particle as the electrons inside the solid state system. And so in this case, it is obliged to obey the Pauli principle. And in this case, it fills an exchange and a correlation with the other electrons. And so in this case, the screening is composed also by this quantum part. So this quantity is more is rather used internally in theory. Internally in theory may have sense to use it, but when you are comparing with the experiments are classical. So it's a classical realm. So, sorry for delaying you.
Another question. What's the difference between the exchange correlation candidate in GFP and the medicine?
Oh, very good question. And okay, I'm going to answer if I have time at the end. Okay, so no, I can already tell you something. Ready? So, the better something that can. Allora, for those who still don't know the Bethe-Salpeter kernel, I invite you to wait for the lecture by Laura. However, here I can already anticipate that it's working. The Bethe-Salpeter kernel is a 4-point quantities. So I'm going to write it in black. I'm going to write everything on the blackboard. So the exchange correlation kernel of TDFT is a functional of the density, so I use a square bracket, and a function of R prime is given. Okay? So it's a 2-point quantity. The space point of view is a 2-point quantity. While the kernel of Bethe-Salpeter, this is a quantity which is a 4-point quantity, so it is the more general cases R1, R2, R3, R3, and R4, R4. Now, it is possible to write a relation between the two quantities, but it is not that straightforward. This I'm going to write at least in a diagrammatic form in my lecture, and then I hope that Laura.
Yes,
more.
I can mention that then.
So you will see that the TDFT is a much more easier theory compared to the subquantity. You have a quantity which is just only non-local, okay, or T or frequency dependent omega. Okay? Yeah. That's right, there's a frequency dependence in this case, rather. And while in the case of the Bethe-Salpeter kernel is a quantity which depends on three and four space points, and why there is only one, let's say there is only one T, and here also there are only three T in reality, because the system is time invariant. So the Bethe-Salpeter kernel depends on four R, and if you have to consider only three frequency, while the exchange correlation kernel of TDFT, again, only for time, because the system depends for, you can write this as a TT prime, but it depends just only on T minus T prime. And so you do the Fourier transform rispetto a omega è just only monomial. So in the Bethe-Salpeter kernel, the original exact Bethe-Salpeter equation, you have three frequencies. On two of them, you have to integrate. So there is the Bethe-Salpeter equation is an integral over two of these two frequencies, and the other is the external frequency. Well, in this case, we are just only the external frequency without integration. So TDFT is a much more easy approach to take on neutral excitation.
So you could say that time-dependent TFT is like a single particle theory, or
no. Not saying that. That is no. I can let's say I. In any case, it focuses on a quantity which is the density-density correlation function. So this quantity called the P or pi can be defined as the expectation value over the phi of rho var and rho far prime, x is t prime, x, x is r and t, okay? So it's the it contains two density operator, while for a pure single particle theory, you rely just only on one of these, like also in the Green function. So if I express this operator, it should be psi dag of x and x prime, and this is the definition of the Green function. Okay. So you have a variable more with respect to with respect to a theory. You have let's say for creation and distraction of the reader, since that while the single part of the Green function you have just only one six.
You can still model excitonic effects with
exactly this free. Correct, this is very important. So this theory, this TDFT is able, provided you dream this exact exchange correlation kernel or a good approximation for it, you can describe excitonic effects. Okay, so last half hour. So, okay, I'm going to go quickly over things that we can see this afternoon. So about this afternoon, you are going to use this DP code. I'm going quickly, then question about this are going to be analyzed this afternoon. However, this code is a linear response DFT code in frequency reciprocal space and on a plane wave basis. So it's the framework where you are working. You can, by this code, you can calculate dielectric and optical properties, so absorption, reflectivity, and also energy loss in elastic X-ray scattering spectroscopy for all the system, bulk surfaces. And of course, for isolated system is through supercell. So because here we are working in plane wave basis. And then several approximations implemented and et cetera. And so it's a frequency reciprocal space code, different from other code. So reciprocal space is convenient in periodic system, bulk, but also surfaces or wise, so 2D or 1D. Not specifically for atoms, molecules, and isolated, so 0D system. In this case, this is of course more convenient the real space and time approach. And so, for example, the most used code in the literature is the octopus code. In this case, I better to use this code. And then also the frequency space means that you are accessed directly to the spectra. So to do spectroscopy is much more convenient to work in the frequency space rather than in a real time space. In order to have spectra, you have to do a Fourier transform of time evolution to have spectra in omega. And okay, very quickly, because I would like to you to illustrate the results and the several approximations. So again, starting from an interface over a DFT code, so in this case Abinit, you get the Concham energies and wave functions. You inverse Fourier transform from G to R. You build the so-called optical matrix elements rho tilde, which are simple bilinear in Concham orbitals. You Fourier transform these optical matrix elements, and these are constitute the ingredients to calculate the Concham polarizability in the other Weiser formula. And then you buy, so in these steps, you have an inverse FFT, here a direct FFT. Here you have an inversion, if you remember the formula to calculate the polarizability from the Concham polarizability. Then you inject, the approximation of the exchange correlation potential. Then you have the microscopic and the macroscopic electric functions. There are some tricks that avoid, for example, some tricks to avoid, for example, full inversion of matrices. Okay, I'm not entering into all these details. Rather, it's more important to see which are the fundamental parameters of a linear response to DFT calculation. And these are, of course, the number of plane waves that you use to describe the Concham wave function. This is a parameter. You can use the same cutoff used in DFT, but more often, since the TDFT calculation is heavier, it's better to reduce cutoffs since the beginning. So you can reduce this cutoff since the beginning. Then you have also the number of bands is also an important ingredient, because the Concham polarizability, unlike in DFT where you only need occupied bands, in TDFT you need occupied and unoccupied bands. You need the electronic transition between occupied and unoccupied bands. And this is a parameter that control the convergence that you need to converge. You have to put enough empty bands in order for your spectra to be converged. Then another fundamental parameter is the number of plane waves used to represent polarizability and electric matrices as matrices, which can be different from this parameter. It's convenient to keep it different on this parameter, because a TDFT calculation is heavier than a DFT calculation, so you have to reduce whenever you can. And you will see that this parameter, of course, you need a much lower cutoff than the cutoff in DFT and here. And then another parameter of the calculation is the number of omega you are considering to calculate your spectrum. So this is, let's say, something that you can decide, but on the rest, on the other three parameters, you need to run convergence checks. And okay, yes, keep also the CPU scaling for all these parameters. You will see this after. And also other. And let me go to the, so let's devote the last half hour to the result you can get in linear response to DFT. And I start by illustrating you the different approximations, C approximation that you are available, the basic ones. Voilà, the first approximation you can do on the exchange correlation kernel is the random, so-called random phase approximation. Okay, the name has nothing to do, it's only historical reasons. But in this approximation, you neglect the exchange correlation effect to occur. So it may appear to you a very bold approximation, but I remind you that you are neglecting exchange correlation effects in the perturbation. So no, let's say you introduce exchange correlation effect in the DFT calculation. So in the DFT calculation, correctly, you consider exchange correlation potential, LDA, PBE, or whatever, and this is very important because the results are changing a lot, while you neglect these exchange correlation effects in only in the response. So you say this, let's consider just only the R3 part, which is always the main part, and neglect this part at least in the response. And you will see that it's not that bold approximation. And this RPA approximation, in fact, has an analogous correspondent that you already know. You remember when you calculated the Einstein coefficients. So you calculate, you remember when you did time-dependent perturbation theory to calculate the absorption, for example, in the hydrogen atom, to calculate, for example, the Balmer or the other hydrogenic series, so the transition between, for example, the n equal 3 or n equal 2 and n equal 4, n equal 2, etc., or n equal 0, 1 for the Lehmann series, this is the Balmer series. So you know that the difference in the energy, the hydrogen energies, provides you some particular energies in, so the black lines, the black absorption lines you see in the absorption spectrum of the hydrogen atom. I remember you, this is the Balmer series, okay? Then also, not only, so the difference in energies are provided where you can absorb, and this is expressed by this delta, omega minus the possible transition, so the difference in the hydrogen energies, in our case of the Kohn-Chalm energies. Then you can also calculate the oscillator strength of the transition, remember you, by the so-called Einstein coefficient, W final initial state, which was the electric dipole operator matrix elements between the initial and the final states. So it is the electric dipole operator between in electric dipole approximation, okay, between the initial and the final approximation. So this gives you the probability of the of a transition. I remind you that not all transition, even in an atom, are allowed. Some transition are forbidden. Forbidden means that the matrix elements of the electric dipole operator are zero. So it means that, for example, this transition is not has zero probability to occur. And this, for example, you remember the selection rule in the case of the atoms.
Just a question. So this is in the dipole approximation.
Yeah.
And that's not necessarily where we have to live if you think of quadrupolar and
exactly.
That
right.
Are possible but weaker.
Yeah, so exactly.
These are forbidden in the dipole approximation.
Exactly.
I've already made the choice that I look only at dipole.
Thank you. This is
but quadrupole transitions are possible.
I hope you all remember this story. So forbidden, dipole forbidden does not mean completely forbidden. There is a very small probability that this transition occurs if you consider the farther term, which is the quadrupole, and so on. And what are the selection rule in the case of, for example, the hydrogen atom? But for example, delta L. So you cannot make the transition from a D state from an S state. You can make this transition is dipole forbidden, means that in the dipole, the electric dipole matrix elements between an S and a D wave function is zero, but you have still the possibility of a quadrupole transition. So it's a transition that now this probability transition is the height of a peak, while this provides you the energy at which a transition can occur. So you can build a spectrum, an optical absorption spectrum, which is the imaginary part of the electric function, as the energies, so delta-like at the energy transition where it is possible to have a transition and with an oscillator strength. So the 8 of the peak is the probability of the transition. If this is zero, of course, there is no peak and the transition is forbidden, or there is a small peak, which is the contribution of the quadrant. Okay. Now, the RPA approximation without local field effects, you can see if you develop the equation, exactly corresponds to the Fermi's golden rule that you use to, for example, to calculate the spectrum in a hydrogen atom. So this is exactly equivalent. So the RPA is not that bad. So, I mean, in the case of the hydrogen atom, it was working. Okay. And so it's just only an application of the Fermi's golden rule from an atom, a confined system, to a solid. Then you have another very used approximation, which is the adiabatic local density approximation. In this case, the kernel, the exchange correlation kernel, is defined as the function, the functional derivative, the derivative with respect to the density of the exchange correlation kernel of local density approximation, DFT, calculated atomic equal zero. So it's a static approximation, and also is a local in space. You see that there is a delta of R1, it's a local in space and static expression for the exchange correlation. And now, so I anticipate the result that you can get with this different approximation, and we have to distinguish if we are studying isolated, so class molecules, atoms, clusters, or solids systems, because the different approximate and also the spectroscopies you are calculating, because the results differ depending on what you're calculating, what's your system. And so I anticipate that this approximation works quite well in the case of energy loss, both in isolated and solids. In the optical properties of isolated system, they are still working, but there are some problems. In the optical properties of solid, they are not working, both RPA and LDA. And so let's start by having a look at, for example, TDFT results on the energy loss of solids. Here is the energy loss spectrum of silicon. You just only see one peak, just only one is the fundamental plasmon excitation of silicon, which is at 17.2 electron volt. And you can see the result of RPA without local field effects, the dots, RPA with local field effects, and TDLDA. You can see there is an improvement introducing local field effects and also introducing exchange correlation effects. However, the position of the plasma is already correctly captured by even by the energy, it's already correctly captured already by RPA without local field effects. And also, I have to see, I have to say that even if you do a even more rogue calculation, calculating, for example, the plasmon frequency, the Drew, the plasmon frequency, considering the balanced density of silicon, you get at least the energy of the plasmon, 70. You cannot get, of course, the shape of the plasmon, but at least you get the right position of the plasmon is already captured by the Ashcroft-Hermite through the plasmon frequency. Then, however, this is not the through the plasmon frequency formula cannot be used in other more complicated cases, like in the case already shown by Francesco of graphite. In this case, you can see that the energy loss spectrum, so the energy loss functional Q, small q, Q almost zero, but a long different orientation. So Q going to zero, but can be directed in plane and out of plane. But the spectra present two fundamental excitations, you see this system two plasmons, so the Drude formula in this case provides an average position. And these two plasmons associated two different plasmons, two different collective excitation of the electron of the system. The first one is the plasmon arising just only from the pi electrons. So the electrons involved in the pi bonding between the planes, the graphene planes of graphite. While the second plasmon, that is called the total plasmon, is the collective excitation of all the electrons, sigma plus pi electrons of the system. And you can see that the free approximations, RPA without local fields, with local fields at TDLDA, works quite well, at least in the case for the in-plane Q oriented along X and Y case. So in this case, there is no difference between the two. While you see, you start to see a difference between with and without local field effects, you see that the experiment here is red again. So you see that the local field expression is more in agreement with the experiment, while the non-local field presents some spurious feature. And here you see, in this case, you can understand why. Local field effects are important for the out-of-plane transferred momenta, so Q parallel to Z, perpendicular to the plane, and not for Q parallel to the planes, because in this system, the electronic density along the plane is homogeneous, while you experiment strong dishomogeneities across the planes. So the demonstration Francesco has provided you, the local fields and non-local fields macroscopic dielectric function are equivalent in homogeneous system. In the case of graphite, holds for the in-plane response, because in-plane, the system, the density is homogeneous, while in the out-of-plane is inhomogeneous. And so in this case, non-local field effects, non-diagonal elements have a role. And it is important to include these non-local field effects in the response to get the right experimental spectrum. So whenever your system is homogeneous, you can neglect local field effects. Whenever you have a direction in which the density is homogeneous, you can neglect local field effects. Whenever you see that the density is homogeneous, then at that point, the local field effects are custom. Also, you can see that TDLDA and RPA in this case at low Q, so this is an energy loss experiment, low Q, low transfer moment, it's not that important, it's almost the same spectra, so almost the same result, the green and the. However, let me show this case, exchange correlation effects on top of local field effects are important when you go to highest transferred momenta. So in energy loss, you just only sample the Q almost zero case. So you just only see in silicon here, the plasma. In an inelastic X-ray scattering spectroscopy, I remind you that this spectroscopy is more appropriate to sample spectra at large transferred momenta, even beyond the first Brillouin zone. So here we are well beyond the first Brillouin zone. Remember, Q is equal 1.75 beyond the first Brillouin zone. And you will see that while the log transferred momenta, TDFT and RPA, local field effects are almost close to each other. In the case of highest transferred momenta, the green and the black curve are different. And the green curve, the black curve, the TDLDA curve is more in agreement with the spectrum. So it is important to include the exchange correlation effects at large transferred momentum for the energy loss function. And in particular, I show you that this TDFT in this case was able to reproduce, probably it's more evident in this, yes, this is a zoom on this part. So here you can see this particular feature of the spectrum, this particular feature the spectrum, is a so-called Fano resonance. So I remind you that silicon presents at 17 electron volts the plasma, the fundamental plasma frequency. The Fano resonance is the interaction of a discrete excitation, in this case the plasma, with a continuum of the electron hole excitation, in this case this parabolic shape spectrum, and this provides a particular feature which is called the Fano resonance. You can see that the TDFT was able to reproduce this complex Fano resonance. TDLA is almost quantitative, but it's already present in RPA plus local fields, the Fano resonance. So you get interesting physics already doing simple TDFT. Then let me go on to take our optical properties. And I start by by introducing optical properties in, let's say, in more isolated systems, so 1D system. All right, here, on nanotube, carbon nanotubes of different chirality. You will see that the TDFT provide different spectra corresponding to the different chirality. In the experiment, they were unable to select a given chirality, so they were measuring all chiralities at the same time. And so theory was able to interpret the experiment, the free features which are present in the experiment, ABC, as the absorption feature of the three different chiralities. We also calculated other chiralities, but these chiralities were absent in the experiment. And so we were able to interpret all the features of an experimental absorption, optical absorption spectrum. Also, this was a long, you know that light has a polarization, and this was a linear polarization, and the linear polarization was along the tubes, where the tubes are homogeneous, while perpendicular to the tubes, again, the story of graphite, the density is inhomogeneous. And in fact, you can observe that according, so the experiment can be done with light polarized parallel or perpendicular to the tube axis. And you can see that there is a huge difference. Okay, here I just only have the experiment for the perpendicular polarization. And you can see that there is a huge difference in considering local fields effects in the perpendicular polarization, here for carbon and borometrine nanotubes. You can see that this is the non-local field spectrum. Then you have a real depolarization effect. So the spectrum becomes almost transparent. The system becomes almost transparent at this frequency when you take into account local field effects. And you will see that the experiment presents these depolarization effects. So along the perpendicular polarization, it is important to consider these local field effects. And these are changes a lot the shape of the spectrum. And while in the parallel polarization, it was not this case. Okay, no, I'm sorry, here I have not shown, but another, probably have another slides. Okay, so again, check at the density inhomogeneities of your system. Whenever you are aware that there are density inhomogeneities, introduce local field effects. Okay, the same for nanowires. So this, okay, in this case, you see the effect of local fields. So here is the parallel to the wire polarizability. And you see that RPA without and with local field effects spectra are almost the same, while you have these depolarization effects in the Y direction perpendicular to the Y.
So similar also for 2D materials.
Sorry?
So similar trend for 2D materials.
Yes, yeah. similar trend for several 2D materials. Yes, let's say that.
Does it also apply to materials that are strongly correlated, where you have a local, like a local higher density of electrons, some orbitals?
Yeah, exactly. So again, I didn't mention, but DFT is in a principle exactly even for strongly correlated system for ground state properties. TDFT is in a principle exactly for excitation, neutral spectroscopy. So in principle, you can describe strongly correlated system. And with CIMO, we did an interesting work. I don't know if I present here. No, sorry, I do not present here. We calculated we measured and calculated inelastic X-ray scattering spectra, so energy loss spectra, in a critical temperature, so in HTC superconductor, WICO, which people consider strongly correlated, and we get a very close agreement. You can say, no? We was even surprised by the agreement we got sorry, I didn't present. So if TDFT works even in strongly correlated system, it can describe even localized states like D electrons. We were perfectly able to describe, for example, excitations in which D states were involved in white.
With non-local fields, with non-local fields.
No, events. With local fields.
With local fields.
With local fields, yes, yes, of course. Now, in the case of D, you can see the difference when D electron excitation is involved. Local fields play an important role. When you are considering SP, electron excitations. In that case, since the SP are much more homogeneous, isotropic, in that case, local field effects have less effects, like here, you can see, more or less. Like, sorry that they don't have, but okay, this was a very complex system, like, so many collective plasma excitation, single particle, so it's not not an example to be brought to a school. But of course, is an example that witnessed to you that TDFT is an in principle exact theory even for strongly correlated system. And then, okay, I mentioned the story about the optical absorption in a isolated system, and here on clusters, lithium-8, sodium-8, and methane. So again, the experiment is the blue. And you can see the RPA without local field effects. So in this case, local field effects play an important role. It's an isolated system. So the density goes from to zero in all directions. And you can see that the RPA without local field effects corrected by local fields. And then also there is a somehow correction by exchange correlation effects toward the experiment. In some cases, the agreement is correct. So in some other cases, however, you still have some error. TDLDA is again an approximation. We don't have the exact exchange correlation kernel of theory. Finally, you can also get excitation energies, not spectra, directly excitation energy. So the polarizability chi, the poles, so chi contains both the spectra, right, and the poles of chi are the excitation energy of the system. But you can calculate the excitation energy of the system through the more straightforward equation, which is called the Cassid equation, this one. So it's a kind of Schrödinger-like equation, and the eigenvalues of these equations are the poles of chi. The kernel of this equation is the R3 plus exchange correlation kernel of the theory, expressed in terms of transition, the transition space. So T is CMV bilinear, okay, KCV in a solid. Okay. And so you, in the kernel, you have a diagonal part constituted by the Kohn-Sham excitation energy, plus, so you just only have this one, the excitation energy of chi will be the excitation energy of the Konsham polarizability, which are the Konsham energy differences. When you introduce the exchange correlation kernel, you modify this excitation energy toward the reality, toward the real system. Konsham are fictitious electrons, never real electrons. And if you solve this equation, you can calculate the excitation energy in a real system. You can also, let's say, these two equations are equivalent. This one allows you to calculate directly the squared, while in this case, you calculate something which can be even complex, okay? And you see this Cassid equation is very similar to the Bethe-Salpeter equation. To answer your question, the only difference is that in Bethe-Salpeter, we have this term, the V term, and then we have the W term, which has a different shape. So in Bethe-Salpeter, rather, you have something which is the W is in this direction. So here you have two delta here, then the W. While in the case of TPFT, you have two delta here and then PC, because the kernel, it depends just only on two. R and R prime, while in the Bethe-Salpeter kernel, you still have this. And so there are some analogies, and this equation is very similar to the Bethe-Salpeter equation you will see on the case. And these are the results you can get again at the example of the helium atom. And the helium atom, you have the exact solution, because you have the exact numerical solution in the case of the helium atom, even the not only the ground state energy already shown, but you have also the excitations. And here I report the excitation of the helium atom. So you have, for example, the 2-3s, the 2 excitation, S and P, singlet and triplet. Triplet is red and singlet is blue. So all these one are in very good agreement with the experiment. So the exact excitation. And then you can see what are the performances of TDFT. All right, I start here by plotting the DFT, because since we can do an exact DFT in the helium atom, we also have the exact Konsham energies and the exact Konsham energy transition. This part here, okay, this part here of the kernel. So if I put the kernel to zero, I will have just only the DFT part, DFT energy differences, and these are the what you will get using this exact Konsham potential. And you will see this, the exact Konsham potential is bad to reproduce the Homo-Lumo gap, but it's good to reproduce optical excitation. So I remember you what was, I don't remember now because it was written in Artri, but you will see that the Konsham system is more appropriate to describe the optical band, the optical gap respect to the Homo-Lumo band gap. You start already from a good position. Then, okay, unfortunately, we don't know the exact exchange correlation kernel. In this system, it is not possible to do a reverse engineering to have the exact exchange correlation kernel of helium, but we can apply the adiabatic LDA kernel. And you can see that the result is not far from the exact one in this. In particular, the split of singlet and triplet is correct. But the split comes just only from the Artri term, not the exchange correlation. While the exchange correlation determines the absolute position with respect to the exact. So the error here is just only the error here, the absolute error here, not the split, is due to the approximate the adiabatic LDA approximation. But you will see that it's not that bad, the LDA, compared to an exact result. In particular, it is able to reproduce the whole Rydberg series. It's the Rydberg series until the continuous polarization. So there is somebody talking, then somebody will. Okay, finally, okay, in this part I cannot go more in deep, just only saying that unfortunately on the optical properties of solids, all the free approximation here studied, so RPA without local fields, RPA with local fields, TDLDA, including local field effects, cannot reproduce optical properties in solids, here again in silicon. So this is the Lautenschlager ellipsometry experiment of the optical absorption. You can see that, there are two problems. The optical onset, the optical gap is underestimated in TDLDA. So you see that the onset occurred, there is a redshift of the spectrum occurred before. And also, maybe the spectrum contains the free feature. So this peak one, two, and this shoulder, the experiment, are contained in theory, provided the redshift. But also, you remark an underestimation of the oscillator strength of the first excitation. And okay, you can attribute this effect to, so you can trace back this. Underestimation of the optical gap to the typical underestimation of the band gap in DA, for example. So a self-energy electron-electron effect, while this underestimation is due to the so-called excitonic electron-hole effects. So the neglect of these electron-hole interaction effects, which can be taken into account by an exact exchange correlation kernel, but a TDLDA kernel is unequal. So I don't know, Laura, if you are going to talk also about exchange correlation kernel, how good the exchange correlation kernel in TDFT after Bethe-Salpeter, no?
So, so no, in my slides, I just compare to the RPA level.
Okay.
This was when we dedicated the full Friday.
Okay,
Bethe-Salpeter and TDFT versus.
Okay, allora, I'm just only saying, so this problem can be solved, as you will see.
I can ask on the slides, but
No, no, okay, I'm just only saying very quickly, let's say, not to stop with the sensation that TDFT is unable to describe the excitonic effects. TDFT is, in principle, able, in DEXA theory, to describe even excitonic effects. The correct oscillator strength of the first exciton peak. You know that these two effects can be corrected, you will see in the next slides, by GW. GW corrects the redshift because it corrects the band gap, the fundamental band gap of the system. So the optical gap now in GW is more correct. Still, there is this underestimation of the oscillator strength, and this is going to be corrected by the Bethe-Salpeter equation, which introduced this electron-hole interaction effect, excitonic effects, by introducing this diagram on top of the renormalization of the electron and the hole by GW. And if you do that in Bethe-Salpeter, you will obtain a more correct spectrum. Also, the real part of the electric function is more correct. But also, we can do the same in TDFT let's say, evolving the approximation on the exchange correlation kernel. In particular, I consider here a very simple approximation you can consider, and it is considered in the DP code. So you consider what is important is to describe these excitonic effects to introduce a long-range contribution only. You know that LDA is still, as I told you, a static but also a local kernel. So it's a delta R of R prime. It's missing completely non-local effects. And you can see that not only you need the non-local effects, but ultra non-local effects. So you have to introduce really something which is in real space 1 over R minus R prime, like the Coulomb potential, And in Fourier, in Fourier space, this means one over Q square kernel, like the Coulomb interaction, times a weight, which we have seen is, it is inversely proportional to the dielectric constant, okay? So this was at the beginning an empirical formula, but you can root it into more ab initio frame, a more ab initio frame. And if you consider this LRC kernel here, this one, you plug this into the fundamental equation of TDRT, you get this result, the black line for the optical absorption curve of TDFT in the LRC compared to LDA, RPA, everything is missing the excitonic effects. And this curve now compares more favorably with the Bethe-Salpeter curve. And you can use this kernel in systems where it is not possible to run a Bethe-Salpeter calculation because too large, TDFT is is cheaper. And you can correctly predict the optical absorption spectrum in complex system where the Bethe-Salpeter is unable.
Does this also use the GW input? Or the...
Yeah, that is the point, good point. So you need to first to correct the band gap, that is correct. And then this kernel is just only correcting the excitonic effects. The underestimation, but in principle, the kernel can take into account also the self-energy effect. In fact, in this kernel, we were using just only we started from an already GW corrected, while in the case of the nanoquanta kernel, we were able even to correct the band gap. So this is a work. Mostly done by Francesco. And in this case, we were able to introduce all the effects into a more complex kernel. This is the relation, a kind of reverse engineering. So you know that in Bethe-Salpeter, the most fundamental part, the difference with respect to TDFT is this part in W. And if you consider this diagram, so containing this W, which is also containing the Bethe-Salpeter kernel, 4G Green's function and 2 inverse Kohn-Sham polarizability. This is a 2-point essential correlation kernel, which is also frequency dependent, thanks to the dependence of the frequency K0. If you plug this kernel into the fundamental equation, so Chi, you are even able to reproduce bound exciton, like in solid argon here. So here you can see that solid argon presents a band gap which is 14.1 electron volt, more or less. So inside the band gap, in experiment, you will see discrete lines associated to bound exciton, and you will see a fully hydrogenic series. So n equal 1, n equal 2, n equal 3 excitons, FPX. And you will see that, for example, if you try to reproduce this optical absorption in RPA TDLDA, you will see absolutely nothing. While plugging this kernel, this reverse engineering kernel, you are perfectly able to reproduce the whole series. So, however, this is the reverse engineering. So you have first calculated the Bethe-Salpeter kernel, then without solving the Bethe-Salpeter equation, you do reverse engineering to calculate, to derive the extent correlation kernel of DFT, and then this you plug into the equation of TDFT. So TDFT is an in principle theory in principle able to describe excitons, excitonic effects, so oscillator strength variation in the spectra, and so on. And with this, I would like to conclude. The main message I hope you got is that TDFT is a valid theory, is an in principle exact theory to describe excitation, not for the mission spectroscopy. Charged excitation are outside the limits. So if you want to calculate the band plot, the band gap, TDFT is not the right theory, but is an in principle exact theory to calculate the neutral excitation and neutral excitation spectroscopy, so optical absorption and energy loss or inelastic stress scattering spectroscopy from first principles. So principally, there are no parameters. Then you have seen that, of course, you are obliged, like in DFT, to introduce approximations. And the approximation we have seen, RPA with local field effects is able to reproduce energy loss spectra Q equals zero. You have to introduce exchange correlation effects for IGAS Q. So to describe inelastic X-ray scattering spectroscopy spectra, it's better to use the TDLDA instead than the RPA with local field effects. Local field effects are important when the system are inhomogeneous in the density, while in homogeneous systems, you can neglect them. Then TDLDA is seems able to improve upon RPA in optical spectra in clusters. You have seen this. And then for optical properties in solids, in particular solids with presenting bound excitons like solid argon, so very huge band gap solids, TDLDA, RPA are failing, and you need the more refined canon. In particular, these excitonic effects are reproduced if you have very ultra long range kernel, a local range kernel like LDA is unable to reproduce this. So, thank you. So if you are if you have questions, otherwise we are going to ask questions in the afternoon or what?
Yeah, yeah, because we continue with that.
This afternoon.
So the wide line range of things are more important than the short range one. And in terms of excitonia.
Yeah. Well, I can explain you why.
What is the question, sorry?
No, why the long range is more important than the short range. The long range is important in you have seen in optical properties, not in energy loss. In energy loss, everything is correct, more or less. TDLDA, RPA, you can reproduce the plasmons, and so on. While in solids, you have this breakdown. And why? Because, in energy loss, in optical properties, you are sampling spectra at Q almost zero, because the Q, the transferred momentum brought by a photon, like Simo already said in the first lecture, is completely negligible with respect to the K of the brilliant zone of the K, the order of K in condensed matter. So the Q of a photon, of a visible photon, what is the Q of a visible photon?
Zero.
It's ridiculous. Small.
Ten to the minus 3 angstrom, something like this. Or no, because experimental is order of magnitude much better than us. So you can completely so calculating an optical spectrum means you are referring to spectra at really Q very small, Q going to zero. And when you are solving this fundamental equation of TDFT, you see that the kernel appears close to the Coulomb potential. The Coulomb potential is precisely, VC is precisely 4 pi over Q squared. In Fourier. So in the limit, in the optimal limits, not in the energy loss. Energy loss can be even up to the third Brillouin zone, like in the last excess scattering vector screen. In this limit, this term, so the R3 part of the kernel, is very large. Q is very small. This is very large. And you can see that A, short range kernel, so Nusselt has not this Q is a constant, so Q going to zero. Short range is constant, it does not present this 1/Q². This term is completely negligible. So you either you put like in LDA, or you don't put this kernel like in RPA, you don't see any difference. And you have seen this in the spectra. So in optical properties, it is important to have something which is doing something with respect to this. This is a very large number. You see here. So you need a Q square behavior, long range contribution, in this case, in order to have an effect with respect to the only architect which does not contain excitonic effects. But this is the reason why you need it is absolutely necessary kernel like this in order to describe in the optical limit. In the energy loss, the short range is enough. Because in that case, Q is large, and so long range is not any more important.
So the Cassida equation updates the spectrum and the oscillator strengths. So you can run it self-consistently to get rid of the Goldschlagen.
Not in linear response. Again, linear response. In linear response, you in practice you consider the system as settled in the density functional in the Cochran density functional theory approach. So the self-consistency is already performed at that level. And then in linear response, you consider just only the small variation that you can have applying a small perturbation. So, I mean, you can do a second step, but this second step means that you are considering, so you are just considering something which you consider, say, a delta of rho, which is a function of delta v. Okay, so this one, say this one is Cochran, okay, in the Cochran approach. In the second step, this, you can use even smaller correction. So let's say a second iteration is completely negligible. You already know that. In linear response means that you just only need looking
it's worthwhile to really underline the question that Kai, since is exact, like Valerio said, this is exact if you had everything. So the Kai zero is the Cochran. So it contains the Cochran wave function, which are not, for example, those that gives you the correct energies, but it's exactly those quantity that has to be put in chi zero. So that's not an approximation. Chi is exact only because you put the chi zero Cochran there. And then you put the variation of the same potential that you put in the ground state, V and FAC, to obtain the exact chi. And so even in Casida, you should only put, without any correction, the wave function of the Cochran. Of course, we don't know the exact chi zero. It's chi zero with LTA, GGA, or whatever. But it's not going towards, let's say, better than Cochran that we solve the problem. In principle, in fact, the Cochran should be there and should give the exact result.
What if the Cochran predicts the wrong ground state?
Yeah, of course, if your ground state is badly described by the chi zero, your chi will not do any miracle, and it will be also wrong. So you can imagine to go towards better something, but it's important that the things that enter there is not something, let's say, better than Cochran. For example, using quasi-particle or using a chi zero coming from another approach with Green's function, for instance. No, I mean, in that formula, the chi zero must be Cochran. And of course, we know that LTA sometimes is not enough, and we have to help it in a different way. You put U, or you go towards GW, but it's not necessarily, let's say, in principle better. We do what we can.
You see that, okay, this question contains, you can have chi zero exact if you have the exact correlation potential of the exact DFT, and if you have the exact exchange correlation current, everything else. But here you have two approximations, because you are considering an approximation for K-naught. It can be coherent. K-naught can be calculated in LDA, and here can be calculated in adiabatic LDA. Or can be incoherent, so you can even use an hybrid to do really dirty things, and here local. Okay, you can also play with them, because you can consider, let's say, since these two quantities are not observable, you can modify, if you know the exact, you can modify them in order to have the kind. But you don't need self-consistency, because this equation, you can solve this equation without self-consistency. You can put, so I brought the expression, the exact expression of chi that you can calculate without doing, So if you have chi Cochran, the fixed C, you can build this matrix, invert this matrix, multiply by this matrix, you get direct chi without need of, in linear response, you don't need to do self-consistency. While in the real space approach, Claudio is going to to teach you tomorrow. In that case, it's like in the Consham, in the NT Consham system, you have to do cell consistency in order to converge to the exact evolution of the density. In linear response, you don't need.
Sorry? If you totally neglect the FXC and reduce it to RPA, basically your dressed chi is just the response to Hartree.
Exactly.
It's Hartree, time-dependent
exactly.
Hartree.
This is time-dependent Hartree, good. In chemistry, they call it time-dependent Hartree.
Yeah, so
good.
It has thank nothing
you.
To do with time DFT.
Yeah, true, because
the
yeah.
FXC is...
But it is a density. The density comes from BFT. It's not the Hartree density.
Okay.
Orbital.
But it's true. You can do it in the, for example, here, instead of doing BFT, you do Hartree. So you calculate the chi Hartree, and then you put on top the only this. And so this is the what is called time-dependent Hartree. And this has nothing to do with the BFT. But also, you can also do time-dependent Hartree Fock. You are chemists. You come from chemistry.
No.
You can do also the independent Hartree Fock. The independent Hartree Fock, what do you do? You solve Hartree Fock equations. So you have the Hartree in the exchange in that case. You calculate the Hartree Fock exchange correlation orbitals. Then you calculate the chi Hartree Fock. Again, this formula holds also in the case of Hartree Fock. So you have a chi not Consham Hartree Fock. And then you also use this formula.
Exchange,
yeah. And here you put the not FXC, but you put FX only, the exchange kernel. In this case, it's called time-dependent Hartree Fock. However, this FXC is similar to the Bethe-Salpeter kernel without the W, so only the V term.
The problem is that the chemist also called that RPA. Right.
So pay attention at the notation. However, thank you. You were very attentive. This is called time-dependent Hartree. But yeah, if you neglect something, you really enter into the Hartree domain. Or if you in also in DFT, in DFT. They introduce this kind of DRT hybrids, but this DRT hybrid contains the Fock. So it's rather a modified Hartree Fock rather than DFT. So the hybrids, I hereby assume the responsibility to say that the hybrids have nothing to do with DFT. It's rather an Hartree Fock modified, a generalized Hartree Fock method, not a DFT method. Because most of the task is done by the exchange part of the hybrid, not the correlation part. The correlation, if you neglect the correlation part, this is changing almost nothing in the final your result. So why are you calling this DFT and not the generalized Hartree Fock? It's always a question of names, but I think that more correct my version than
generalized correlation. But Consham is not DFT.
Consham is DFT. Con is the basis of DFT. Then, as somebody asked me, you.
No, Consham is a formulation of DFT.
Formulation of DFT. Right. Okay. However, also the DFT without Consham is also nothing to do with the hybrids.
No.
And also, I remind you that one of the last conferences attended by Walter Kohn, Nobel Prize Walter Kohn, was the 33 General Density Functional Theory Conference. In this conference, for the first time, they were presenting hybrids. At the time,
exact exchange.
At the time, there was just only exact exchange. And so Walter Kohn was looking at all this presentation. At the end, he raised the hand. And asked, but I did a huge effort to formulate in a rigorous mathematical form, exact form, this density functional theory. And this density functional theory allows a constant system whose exchange correlation potential is local. And this is a great simplification with respect to an artifact calculus. Why are you making it again local? Why my huge effort was to demonstrate that this theory local is exact as well, at least for certain property? This question has to be recorded, not mine. Because this is history of density functional theory, and everybody has to listen to what the father of density functional theory told polemically in one question.
The problem is that sometimes it's very difficult to have explicit functional of the density. And also for Kaneshanov, we use Kaneshanov for the kinetic part. It's much more easy to achieve to express the kinetic or using in terms of simple particles. Then you have the same problem on the exchange.
Yeah, true. So, okay, however, this is due to the fact that the physicists reduced mathematical knowledge. And if we were more proficient in functional analysis, so in functional analysis we know very little. Banach spaces for us is a mystery. If we were able to manage better this concept, we can manage better functionals instead than introducing orbital dependent potentials. Hybrids are orbital dependent. Okay, we can continue this afternoon if you like. For example, there is a question that I could not answer to all the questions that were asked before, but he reminded me the question of the kinetic energy. So there was somebody asking me the question of the kinetic energy. This afternoon, during the tutorial, we can also interrupt from time to time to answer. If you have questions, now we go to lunch, but you write it and we can answer this after. Okay. Thank you.
Just an order of magnitude for the photon, optical light photon. So the momentum is about 1,000 of an inverse angstrom for 2 eV photon. This means that for the dipole approximation, if we take the exponential of k dot r, r being, let's say, the first Bohr radius, 0.529 angstroms, which would be the length scale in atomic scale, like physics, right? Then it means that the quadrupole term is 5 times 10 to the power of minus 4 weaker than the dipole part, and then the octopole is even weaker. So it's not negligible, it's not zero. It's small, but not zero.
An approximation because it's considering important problems. Okay, so
Adrian,
yes.